So Neethi Suktankar is the offering manager for mobile in the IBM Cloud division based in Bangalore. Neethi has had a varied and multidisciplinary career, starting in advertising and moved to IT in the sunrise years of IT in Bangalore in the late 90s. As a communications expert, she joined Logica CMG, which is now known as CGI, as an information developer, and moved to IBM by intent in 2007 to get exposed to the technological finesse, foresightedness, and innovation that IBM User Assistance was leading the pack in. Neethi worked as a practitioner, an architect, and a manager, leading global teams and innovation missions for Rational Software at IBM. We do have one technical writer who's still working on Rational Software. I'll introduce you to her later. So she then had a serendipitous outing as the technical assistant for the vice president of the IBM India Software Lab, where she was initiated into formulation and execution of business strategy and operations management for the lab and worldwide development teams. Last year, Neethi took on the role of offering manager as it brought together all the dimensions of her experience, strategy, markets, and technology, and affords her the opportunity to capture market direction and customer needs, formulate product strategy, and manage execution. Through it all, Neethi remains a committed user champion and advocate, passionate about building iconic experiences for her users. She has previously spoken at STC conferences and meetups and enjoys sharing her insights on technology and human topics. In this keynote, Neethi will share data and insights on the latest technological trends shaping the business landscape, mapping how it will transform industries and experiences, and separate the hype from the reality. She'll also share her thoughts on what these changes mean for information developers and the opportunities and challenges that they need to be aware of. Exactly matches the theme, what do you say? It does, right? So this is great pleasure, Neethi, to have you here. I'll request Neebu to welcome you on behalf of STC India. Welcome, Neethi. We are really Thank eager you. To hear you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, guys, for having me here. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. Like Mugdha read out in my bio, I'm no stranger to these conferences or to this discipline. I've sat here like you guys several years, and I wondered at times what it would take for me to be standing up here and delivering the keynote. Turns out two things need to happen. A, you need to stop being a tech writer, and secondly, your original keynote speaker has to bail. Thankfully for me, both these things came true, and I grabbed the opportunity when Anandita called me. So I hope you guys can take away something from the things that I have learned in the last couple of years. Is this mic working? Yeah. So what I really want to do today is talk to you a little bit about how is technology changing. And I mean, you know, all of us are aware of how technology is, the pace at which technology is changing. So I want to talk to you, give you a little bit of perspective on the technology landscape, how it's really impacting businesses, how it's really impacting customers, and what it means for technology workers and technical communicators. And then put all of that information in context. Technology, you know, who is this? What is the value that the technology is really driving? What is it that information developers and technical communicators need to be aware of? You know, what are the opportunities that they really need to harness, and what they need to do to make sure that, you know, they are being real and true to their audiences. So I have 30 minutes. It's about 9:30 now. I have a lot of ground to cover. May not have time for question and answer on the podium, but I'll be around, and you know, feel free to come and chat. So I was looking at the agenda for your conference, and I saw, you know, there's a bunch of stuff around AI and chatbots and really, artificial intelligence and its, various forms have really captured the imagination of the entire technology ecosystem today. But I wanted to spend a few minutes to give you a little bit of insight into not just AI, but there are other things and other technologies in the ecosystem today. Cognitive is a term that IBM likes to use because artificial intelligence can be a loaded term. What is sort of cognitive systems? Cognitive systems is really self-learning systems that behave and act like the human brain. They learn like the human brain and then can provide recommendations and predictions. Quantum technology. Have you guys heard of quantum? Do you know how it, So let me give you a sort of layman's explanation of quantum. Quantum technology really, or quantum computing, works on the principles of physics, which admits the possibility that matter can exist in different states. And what quantum computing does is it solves problems, and it solves problems at a scale that classical computers cannot. Quantum computers will solve problems that it would take, that classical computers either cannot or will take decades to solve. And how does it do it? For classical computers, a bit can be either 0 or 1, right? We are all aware of that. A qubit in quantum computing admits the possibility that a qubit can be both 0 and 1 at the same time. So it opens up like a range of possibilities. And how does it get applied? For example, imagine a very complex maze that a computer had to decode. It would start at the beginning, it would traverse one path, reach a dead end, and come back to the beginning, and then start again. So imagine this in the context of something like a caffeine molecule. A caffeine molecule cannot be decoded by classical computers because a caffeine molecule exists in various different stages. A classical computer cannot grasp that. But a quantum computer will admit the possibility that a molecule can be in different stages and it will traverse all the paths and reach the endpoint. So it will actually traverse all the paths at the same time. So quantum computing is really optimized for massive computing workloads, and it can process information in speeds and in volumes that classical computers cannot. So it really expands the range of stuff that computers can do. VLSI system, very large-scale integration systems. What do these do? They actually mimic the wiring of the human brain, and they respond to sensory data in ways that are not programmed. So, all of these quantum and VLSI systems are really driving the marches that are happening in artificial intelligence and machine learning. And then ubiquitous, very simple terms, everything around you is a computer. We've all heard of the refrigerator use case. How wonderful, it is that you will never run out of milk again. So all of these computers working together, sync together, they anticipate your needs and they act in ways that really improve your lives. So these are all of the computing paradigms that are coming together today and really changing the technology landscape. What does that mean for businesses? It means that today, with the scale of technology, no business is immune from the impact of these changes, whether it's technology, whether it's banking, whether it's insurance, whether it's energy, travel, transportation. Every single industry is in the throes of these changes. Okay. I talked about ubiquitous computing. I remember back, is Akash here by any chance? I remember he had done a session on, and I think at that time the projection was that we would have about 2 billion connected devices by 2016. I think we've broken, that projection. By 2020, we are saying 212 billion. What is the human population today? Put that in context. And, you know, since AI is really, you know, cognitive and artificial intelligence and machine learning is really driving a lot of the changes that we are seeing today, both in terms of, you know, overall technology and also, you know, for you guys in technical communication, I want to just sort of give you some data to help you understand the scale of adoption of this change and the scale of its reach. One of my VPs, who's my mentor, a very close mentor of mine, told me a year back, he said, you know, if you need to pick a job and if it's an IBM, always look at where the marketing dollars are flowing and pick a job in that division, right? So if I apply that same analogy to a technology landscape, this is where the money is flowing, right? AI and machine learning. And this is the scale of the opportunity. In the cognitive market opportunity in 2020, it's absolutely staggering, right? And if anyone thinks that this technology is not going to impact them, I think you have your head in the sand. So I've, you know, talked a lot about AI, ML, machine learning, cognitive systems. I think all of you are aware of those concepts. Are you aware of the differences in those concepts? Do you know how artificial intelligence is different from machine learning, is different from cognitive systems? So I'll take a minute or two to explain the difference to you, and why I'm explaining this will come together as we reach the later part of this talk. So these terms are used interchangeably, and people tend to, what I call machine learning, someone will call artificial intelligence. And I'm really not a technical expert, but this is IBM's sort of interpretation of these three terms. Machine learning is the most basic aspect of artificial intelligence. It means systems that are able to learn from data. So you take a machine learning system, feed it data, and then it's able to identify patterns from that data and understand it. And that understanding happens the way the human brain functions. It learns, it relearns, it refines its learning. So for example, and it's very, very similar to human learning. I mean, you know, you have kids, you buy them picture books, right? And you keep showing them, oh, this is an apple, you know, it's red. And it's not enough for you to just buy one book, right? All of us have bought like multiple books which have the same A for apple, but you know, it's just additional sensory data. So you keep feeding that. So for a machine learning system, I'm training that on the human body, right? I keep showing it pictures of say the cardiovascular system or the respiratory system, and it starts understanding, oh, this is a picture of a lung. Oh, this is how it relates to the cardiovascular system or the respiratory system. Oh, this is an adult lung and this is a, you know, child's lung. So the next time I show it a picture of a lung, it'll say, oh, that's a lung. I know that that's a lung. So that is machine learning. And the most commonplace application of that is Facebook's facial recognition system. You upload a picture, it'll say, oh, this is Neethi and, you know, this is Mugdha. Take that a step higher. What is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is when you can take that data and then start identifying, relating it to other things that you know and learn, and start applying that to advanced tasks. So for example, a machine learning system who knows what a lung is, it also knows, oh, what is a colony of bacteria look like? I then show it a picture of another lung, and it says, wait, that's not right. That lung is probably infected because I can see colonies of bacteria in it, right? So it's handling more advanced tasks, it's relating information, and it's making certain hypotheses. Then you take that a level higher. When you come to cognitive systems and cognitive computing, it is then able to tell you, oh, this is an infected lung and this needs treatment. This is the antibiotic that you should treat it with, and this is why it will work for patient A, because I am now relating it to her genetic history and the efficacy of this antibiotic to that patient's genetic history, right? So it provides recommendations. And at the same time, the critical thing to understand here is it provides evidence-based recommendation. If I'm giving you a recommendation, I can then provide evidence to say why I'm giving you this recommendation. So search online if you're interested in this. In 2015, I think in Japan, there was a patient who came to the biggest hospital in Tokyo with, you know, leukemia. She was diagnosed with myeloid leukemia, and they put her on a treatment of chemotherapy. After the treatment was administered, her recovery was not very fast, and they said something is not right. So they took all of her patient data and fed it to IBM's Watson oncology advisor. Watson was able to cross-reference her genetic data with all of the 200 million patient records that it had, and it was able to strip away all of the genetic markers that were not relevant to the disease. And in 10 minutes, it was able to come up with a diagnosis of saying this is a very rare form of leukemia and recommended a treatment. It saved a life, right? So this is where cognitive computing is really headed, and this is where the real value of AI and ML is. So, you know, don't lose sight of that. So what is the real promise of AI? The real promise of AI is in prediction or recommendation. So we talked about what the technology is doing. What is it then doing for businesses? Amazon.com today, it recommends, when you go to its website, it'll make, say, a recommendation of 20 things that you could possibly buy based on your preferences and your buying history, right? That's a 5% conversion rate. Amazon is looking at a future which is not very far out, when it is able to anticipate at an 80 or 90% accuracy of what you need before you need it. And it will be able to do that how? As machine learning models and the data that is available to these machine learning models becomes more and more available. There's more rich data, and the cost of prediction of machine learning starts coming down. It always happens. What will it do? How will Amazon transform its business model? Every week, based on what it knows you need, Anindita has a business dinner to go to this evening because I know her calendar is blocked. I know she likes to wear formal trousers. Let me send her a trouser and a shirt and throw in a pair of shoes that I know she likes. Or there is a rainstorm headed her way. I know she doesn't have a raincoat because she planned to buy it this weekend because that's what I got from Amazon Echo, which is, you know, in her home. And but the rain is going to hit her earlier. The rain forecast is going to hit earlier than planned. So she needs that raincoat on Friday. So Amazon is going to send you every week 20 packages based on goods that they know you want. You keep what you really want and you return the things you don't want. So the entire push and pull model changes. And even for the for taking back the things, you don't have to do anything. They know when you're ready to return the things, and their truck will come by and pick it up. And this is not something I've made up. Amazon has filed a patent for anticipatory shipping. Go read about that. It's fascinating. They filed a patent for anticipatory shipping, and it's basically it. And what is it modeled on? It's essentially modeled on refined, advanced machine learning, cognitive systems, data coming together. What does this actually mean for users? For users, it means that future for them is intensely personalized. Every single experience that you have via technology is personalized to your context. And because of the additional layer of artificial reality, augmented reality, virtual reality, it'll be completely immersive. And with the application of things like chatbots, it will be conversational, right? There are terms, the commerce or the retail domain now is talking about conversational commerce as the next big thing. Every single retail company is now heading to that direction, and it's all fueled by AI, right? So for users, it means that the future is intensely personalized. Let me take a very quick use case. You're supposed to travel, right? Your mobile device knows that you're supposed to travel, right? It's a no-brainer because you book tickets, your calendar is blocked. What it does is few days before your travel, it goes and starts downloading stuff that you either want to read, if you're a reader, or if you like to watch content, audiovisual content, you'll start downloading episodes of a show that you haven't had the time to watch, and it'll save it on your mobile device. You go to the airport, your mobile device will sync with the airport mapping system and say, here is where you need to go to reach your security gate. Your security gate changes, you get a push notification on your Apple Watch. You get recommendations for shopping and restaurants based on your location and your proximity in the airport. And you know, your entire sort of check-in and all of that is aided by robotic assistance. So essentially, that is the kind of experience that is getting created. Now, let's just take a moment. In the last 10 minutes, I started from, you know, pure technology, business models, user or customer experiences. So do you see how we are, where we are headed? We are headed to technology getting applied to users. Ultimately, where does it all come together? Where does technology really come together? Where is the real value of technology? The real value of technology is in creating iconic user experiences. And this is my first keeping it real insight. So never ever lose sight of the fact that technology is never an end in itself. And who are you building the technology for? It's your user. Your user is at the heart of all of that technology. You're building a chatbot. So what if you're building a chatbot? Who are you building the chatbot for? What problem are you solving? What value are you adding? I mean, if a user has an experience through a written piece of content, why do you need to create a chatbot for it? So the foremost and primary objective of technology is to improve human lives. It's to optimize human effort. It's to aid human enterprise, right? And the user is at the center of it. And you guys are the user advocates. So that reality is never changing. Even though you have a robotic assistant who's, you know, giving out information, you are the person who's creating that robotic assistant. You are the one who's creating that that experience. So, you know, in my job as an offering manager, I am in charge of strategy, in charge of figuring out and anticipating market direction, understanding what changes the technology is going to bring, what is the kind of roadmap, product roadmap I need to construct for my product, what do my customers want, what are the sales teams doing, what are the problem support teams have. But you know what the first line of my job description is? The first line of my job description is create iconic user experiences. So apart from all the, you know, drive revenue, make pricing decisions, make the strategy, ultimately it all comes down to user experience. And I think you guys are the ones who are the custodians of the user experience. So never ever lose sight of the fact that ultimately technology comes down to user experiences. There's nothing beyond that and there's nothing short of that. What defines user experience in simple terms, right? If you have to just think for yourself or create a mental map for yourself, three words. And I got this from a Forrester study and I was pleasantly surprised because I thought Forrester, Gartner, IDC, they only deal with numbers. Turns out they also deal with concepts. Three terms. Effectiveness. What was the value of the experience? Right? When a traveler got guided on her Apple Watch or on her mobile device to the nearest security gate without having to look at any signs, what was the value of that experience? Maybe she was running late for a flight and it saved her 10 minutes, right? That's the effectiveness of the experience, the ease, getting value without difficulty, right? How easily did I get that value? Maybe I'm interacting with an emergency service in a hospital, right? I need to know my child is injured. I've run into the hospital. It was able to immediately guide me to the emergency room and connect me to a doctor. Right? It didn't waste time in telling me, hey, Neethi, how are you today? I didn't need that at that time, right? So ease without difficulty and emotion. How good did you feel about the experience? You know, when you order products on Amazon today, when those packages arrive, how good you feel even though you know what's inside that. Imagine the delight when you have 20 packages waiting for you when you go back from work and you don't know what's inside them. So delight, you know, creating customer delight is where you can capture your users and create loyal users. So you guys must be thinking, you know, oh, you know, she's talking about user experience. Maybe it's important to her. It's important to me. Maybe it's important to my user experience designers. Is it really important to my CEO? Yes, it is. Again, backed by data, Forrester did a study of 3,000 enterprises and non-enterprises in 2016. You know what is the most critical? This is the topmost problem that they have, or the topmost sort of motivation that they have to adopt digital transformation, is to create unique customer experiences and drive engagement. And today, even though everyone is looking at user experience, not very many companies feel that they're doing a good enough job on it. So, I mean, you cannot think that, you know, work is done in this space, you know. Apple has come here, you know, we all understand the importance of user experience. Every time you're creating or applying a piece of technology, it's all about the experience that you create through that technology. How many of you are aware of this little data thing that Tom Goodwin, who's the CEO of Havas Worldwide, which is a media and communications firm, puts out? He says, Uber is the largest taxi rental company in the world but owns no cars. Have you guys heard that? I think it gets bandied around in all the conferences. Facebook is largest social media company, owns no content. Alibaba is the largest retailer, has no inventory. Airbnb is the largest holiday rental but owns no properties. But why are these properties at the top of their game? Because it's all the battle of the interface. The interfaces are the ones winning the war. And who should be responsible for the interface? You guys should be responsible for the interface. You are the ones who should have empathy for the users, their context, and you should be contributing actively to this. Never step back from that exercise. Because the interface is real. The interface is where the technology is coming together. And, you know, in a room where, you know, you're probably with your offering manager, your technology leader, your, you know, business leader, it's very easy to lose sight of empathy for the user. You have to always wear, you know, the customer's hat and be the customer advocate in that room. It's, like I said, it's not enough to just build a chatbot and say, hey, I built a chatbot. You have to be able to explain what is the problem that you solved for the user. So leading up to my next insight, and if you go back to the difference that I explained between AI, ML, and cognitive, I've got some little factoids there. AI is data, maths, patterns, and iteration. I think I explained that. Basically, you take data, you derive patterns from it, you apply algorithms to it, and you keep iterating, learning, relearning. AI is actually training data, machine learning. Training data can be both unstructured and structured. AI model, when you build an AI model for your chatbot, and people who've done that know this, you'll have to classify entities, intents, and responses. Entities is what is the categories of data that you're teaching your ML system about. Is it number of is it types of restaurants, cuisines, locations, all of that. Intents is what is the questions customer is going to ask you, and what are the responses you're going to provide. And then there's a little event that happened some time ago. Google acquired Kaggle, the world's largest data science community. Anyone wants to take a wager on what is the insight that's hidden here? The insight is that AI is data first and only as good as it. It's all about the data. AI systems are dependent on data. You show them, you know, a picture of a kidney and say that's a lung, it'll say, okay, that's a lung, right? So what does that mean for you? It means, look at that, training data can be both unstructured and structured. Who creates the structured data? You guys create the structured data. So the onus is on you to make sure that the structured data that the AI system is learning from is accurate, cleansed, and specific and precise. Because when your chatbot or your virtual assistant is interacting with your user, if your training data is no good, the user experience is not going to be any good. So it actually rests on you. Unstructured data. Unstructured data is today, 80% of the data that exists today is unstructured. My CEO, Ginni Rometty, says data is the world's new natural resource. It's the new oil. But what is the problem with the data today? What is the biggest problem that data scientists are dealing with today? 80% of that data is unstructured and dark data. The day we start deriving insights from that is when machine learning models are going to become as commonplace as, like potatoes. So even unstructured data needs labeling. I'm not saying that's your task. That is something that data scientists do. But it's all about training data. It's about the data that you feed your machine learning model. And there's this company called Crowdflower, which at the last AI conference took this concept of AI equal to training data plus machine learning one notch higher. They said AI is equal to training data plus machine learning plus HITL, human in the loop. Okay, so through all of this, my message to all of you is never lose sight that AI is a thing by itself. Machine learning is a thing by itself. You are creating it. You will bring that experience to life. And you have a new responsibility and a new role today. So with all of these technology changes and the way technology is getting applied, you guys can either be highly relevant or you can be highly irrelevant. Okay? You're going to be highly irrelevant if you continue to do the things you've been doing and you continue to do them in the ways that you've been doing. Why? Because your user is changing. You are now creating content for the digital native, right? What are the things that you could look at leveraging? Experiential learning. So beyond videos and audiovisual content, there will be layers of AR and VR that you can start leveraging in your learning experience, right? That whole VR layer that comes in. I'm trying to change a tire. I get a, information layer on top of it which says, here is the nut that you need to loosen. So AR and VR and, immersive instruction methods. And then I talked about personalization. What does personalization mean? It means you are creating an experience only for myself, only for me. And what do you need to do as user experience advocates? You need to introspect obsessively on the context that a user will be using your application or your technology in. What is the geographical context? What is the temporal context? What is the situational context? Is my user on a holiday? Is my user a doctor? Is my user a knowledge worker? Is my user a teacher? What kind of experience has that user had? What is her temporal situation now? If she's walking into a hospital, how do I need to deal with her? If she's just had a bad experience and she's venting on social media, how do I need to sort of change that experience for her? So you need to be highly sensitive to the context of the user. And it's your job to do that, right? Nobody else is going to do that for you. Your offering manager is going to tell you, this is the technology, this is the use case. But to figure out the context in which the user is going to be using it and to write content and to deliver content in that context is your job. And the focus on the what and why, this is a peeve that I've had from the time that I was a writer. We guys focus too much on the how. And that if we thought of that as a leverage or a power, that's getting taken away completely from us because the interface is taking care of that. You no longer, even if you have senior citizens at home, you don't have to give them a mobile phone or an iPad and tell them how to use it. Interfaces are taking care of that. Your UXD is taking care of that. What do you have to focus on? You have to focus on the what and the why. You can use Watson APIs or Google ML API to build a chatbot. That's fine. Why should I be building it? Can you explain to another fellow writer today what the promise of an AI or a chatbot or a digital or a virtual assistant is and why you should be building it? Can you go and talk to the CEO of a hospital and explain to them why you should be building, say, a digital assistant who welcomes their patients? And that's where the real value of understanding human experience comes in. And finally, you know, I meet so many customers when in my line of work today. You know what they tell me? The first thing that they tell me? The doc sucks. And in my mind, that's a brilliant problem for you guys to have. Because 10 years back, we used to always tell our customers, read the beep docs. Now they tell me the doc sucks. It tells me that they're actually reading the docs. So your user has evolved. They know how to find the doc now, right? But they're still not getting the value from the doc. Why is that? Because we are too focused on the how. We are too focused on writing procedures. So we have to sort of take like a step up and start operating in the realm of the how is the technology going to get applied and what does it mean for my users and how they are going to use it. Effectiveness, ease, and emotion. And finally, you know, I wanted to just end with, that's a picture of Watson Oncology Advisor, and I'm not trying to sell anything here. Watson Oncology Advisor being used at Sloan Kettering Memorial Cancer Center, where hundreds of patients have received better treatments. Lives have been saved because treatment, the most efficacious treatment, was delivered on time. Watson Education is now delivering solutions which is helping students and actually reducing dropout rates. In the US, dropout college school dropout rates are at an all-time high. Watson Education is now reducing dropout rates at you know, small schools in United States, in certain school districts. So that is the real value of technology. So always remember the real context of technology. Technology is for improving human lives. It is for aiding human enterprise. There's no bigger truth than that. And you guys have to take that truth to the larger knowledge working ecosystem that you work in. So that's all I had. I think I'm on time. I'm going to take 2 minutes to quickly tell you a story on personal effectiveness, which was shared with me by a very senior IBM executive who works in our headquarter. I think some of you might already have heard the story. Have you heard the story about JP Morgan? Has anybody heard the story about JP Morgan towards the end of his career? Okay, let me take a shot at it. So JP Morgan, everyone knows he's one of the most well-known bankers. Towards the end of his career, he was approached by a man who said, in my hand, I hold the greatest secret to success and I can give it to you, I'm willing to give it to you for $25,000. JP Morgan said to him, look, I don't know what's in that sheet of paper, but I'll take it from you and I'll read it. And if it makes sense to me, I will pay you the money. So the man handed over the sheet of paper to JP Morgan. He read that, wordlessly wrote the check for $25,000 and handed it over to the man. So what was in that sheet of paper? It said, number one, every morning make a list of things that you need to do. And number two, do them. So, you know, sometimes when all of these changes are upon us, we have a day which is filled with figuring out what do I need to do to contribute to the roadmap, what do I need to do for my users, what do I need to do for my personal growth, what do I need to do to just meet my you know, performance appraisal objectives today. I think focus is of extreme value if you can do that. And the second thing is, you know, never fear the unknown, because the unknown is where the real possibility and where your real growth and success lies. Do what makes you scared. I think the reason I am here today is because one weekend, 2 years back, I read Sheryl Sandberg's Lean In, and I stopped at the point where she said, do what makes you scared. If anything makes you extremely uncomfortable and extremely scared, take the leap and do it. I read that on a Sunday. Monday morning, I went to work and my manager said, you know, there's an opportunity as a technical assistant to the VP of ISL. Do you want to do it? On any other day, I would have said, oh no, I'm happy doing what I am. But immediately, you know, that thing came to my mind. I said, you know what, I'm going to do what makes me scared. So open yourself up to the realm of possibility and do what makes you scared. So that's it. Thank you. I hope this made sense to you. I hope it was useful. And I'll be around and happy to chat.
Most inspiring keynote speaker that I have ever come across with, because generally in the conferences what happens is you get a cloud of words, you know, AI, machine learning, artificial intelligence, chatbots, this, that. You just go home with a list of keywords that you are going to Google after reaching home, and then again try to make sense with the slides what you tried to learn there. This is, for the first time, I'm feeling that, you know, I got a sense of a mind map got created instead of just a cloud of words. So thanks so much, Neethi, for coming at such a short notice and inspiring us so much. Probably in 2 years of IBM, I'm feeling now that, okay, I am literally sitting on such a wealth of, I mean, mine of wealth, that I really want to now go back and start working with a new energy. I really feel that you all are inspired in the same way. And we really thank Neethi, a small token.
Thank you guys, because I learned so much because I started researching and yeah.